Welcome to the Chris and Jalen Show, presented by Just Cash Clothing and the Empower Sportsnet. I am your host, Chris Sarzola.
I'm your co-host, Jalen Chapman, CEO of Just Cash Clothing.
Today, I want to welcome Raekwon O'Neal. Raekwon is a student athlete at Rutgers University. He's part of the football team there. He's also an entrepreneur. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, man. It's been a long time. Hey. Finally got me on the show.
About time, hey. Finally. I'm finally. Fine. Yep. So I want to hop right into it. And so we usually start our show off with a empowered moment. And so basically you can give us a story and or, you know, you could tell us about people that have empowered you in your life. Or you can also tell us a story about how you empowered someone else in their life, you know.
It's the person that empowered me the most is my mother, just seeing her growing up. Working her tail off just to put food on the table for me and my two older sisters. And just seeing her like still raise us and still raise me to the man I am today and to get to where I am, I couldn't be here without her.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, I can relate. I grew up in a single household as well. My mother was a single mother as well. So man, I feel you. And actually to be, believe it or not, actually, my mom actually, she adopted three kids too, as mm-hmm. well, you know, being a single mother and stuff. And so, you know, my mom's seriously an angel as well. So I wouldn't be the person without her as well. So thank you for sharing.
No problem. That's good. But, Raekwon, can you tell us a little about where you're from, please?
The 843 Conway, South Carolina.
843. Yes, sir.
You know, it's a little town. It gets overlooked by Myrtle Beach, you go through Conway just to get to Myrtle Beach. So when I tell people where I'm from Conway, they ask where that's at. I said it's near Myrtle Beach. Okay. Like, oh God, I love that place. Like, yeah, I know.
Yeah,
that little town that you drive past on 501. it's a nice little area, you know. You got like all places got just crimes and gang related stuff, It wasn't like my mom kept us away from all that stuff. Like she did a great and excellent job of keeping us away from all that, from the trouble and stuff. Never was in the streets. Was always safe when it came to coming home.
For real. And you're big on like Southern hospitality. You always say yes sir, no sir, yes ma'am, no ma'am, all the time.
It's force. You don't get smacked in the mouth. No matter who you are, no matter who it is, they will smack you in the mouth. What you say? It's really like the saying is like it takes a village to raise a child. It really takes a village to raise. Like that's how it is down there. It's like everyone's a force. Like man, this is really a big deal.
So, yeah. Wow.
I can tell.
Wow.
And can you give us tell us about your journey to where you are today, kind of like football, like any sport you played when you're younger to get to where you are now?
All right, so I started playing sports, football when I was seven, played football, basketball growing up, tried different sports as well. Didn't really like baseball, so I just took the football, basketball. Actually, no offense, one thing. Huh?
No offense, Chris.
No offense, Chris. It's okay. No, you're good. I told you I played basketball and football too. I just the same thing. My coach was like, yo, like, listen, you're not gonna go, you know, play, so focus on what you need to focus on. So yeah.
So actually I quit football at one point. Fifth grade through seventh grade, I quit. Then I started playing back in eighth grade. Mm-hmm. Then freshman year of high school, it wasn't really like as much fun as it was when I was little. So I talked to the coach, told him, because listen, I wasn't coming to workouts. I wasn't coming to practice.
You weren't applying yourself.
I wasn't applying to myself. My mom wake me up, practice. I told her I'm not going. So I finally talked to the coach. It was like that. I told it to the coach. He just told me, it's like, you already started it. Just finish it out. Just got a place. I did, and then I became in love with it. They moved me from tight end to outside linebacker, then found me a permanent spot at DN. Started at DN. Mm-hmm. Ninth grade, 10th grade, then 11th grade. I got moved over for my freshman junior, my freshman sophomore year, I was tight end and DN on varsity. Then my junior year, that's when I moved to O-line, played tackle, started at tackle, started on defense, both sides, playing both sides of in the game. So it was been a lot coming up.
You did it all.
Played it all. Like even in rec league, you know, rec league, I played running back, fullback, middle linebacker, outside linebacker. You name it, pretty much I played it.
Coming up. So offensive line is still pretty fresh. Then you 5 years basically. Like you've been playing for about 5 years, I guess you could say. Wow, that's crazy though. But that means you still got like all kinds. Like your ceiling's gonna be like crazy high. Then you know what I mean. Like that's awesome though.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. And stayed there permanently. Moved. Played the whole D line. Played offensive guard, offensive tackle. So I got a little bit of experience inside too.
Okay.
Now I am at Rutgers playing left tackle.
Left tackle.
Primarily.
Yeah.
Left tackle. Yeah. Rutgers.
Why did you choose Rutgers? Because, you know, obviously we talked and, you know, you had a lot of different, you had a lot of different offers and a lot of different options. So, you know, why Rutgers?
It felt like home. Felt like home. They welcomed me. What was big with me was the environment, how the campus was, and my major, because we all know that football doesn't last forever.
Yeah.
So I wanted to have a great base and build my network up where I could build it up very well. And Rutgers had the best in my major, which is graphic design, and I chose here. And I also, big reason was, it wasn't, I want to come somewhere I could change the program and people didn't think we could win at. Because I did it in high school before, and I feel like I could do it here too. Because when I was coming up in high school, my eighth grade, from what I can remember, my eighth grade and my freshman year, the varsity team was 2-9. Oof. Then when I got to varsity, we flipped it to 9-2, made the playoffs, and since then we've been in the playoffs.
Wow.
Won the region.
Culture.
I could flip it here too.
Yeah, culture builder.
Yeah.
Come in and change things around.
So, for those that don't know, me and Raekwon were in the same graduating class. We actually went to Rutgers early together.
2018,
best class ever. I'm still living on my brothers. Unfortunately, I transferred for personal reasons. But when we first were freshmen, he was supposed to be my roommate. Actually, some people don't really know that.
Yeah,
he was my assigned roommate. I was like, I don't know if I can do that.
I'm not your boy.
Oh yeah, I called Coach Ash. I was like, I don't know. Yeah, you gotta switch me. He was like, who do you want? I was like, Kiss. He was like, all right. And then end up being, he's one of my best friends ever. I've ever had. So yeah, we still got that. And he lives across the hall from us. So I've seen him every day. And
got it. Every that's single how you
day. So, yeah. That's how we bonded.
Yep.
But yeah. But can you touch on last season, like everything that went down, being like COVID and everything you went through, pretty much.
What was that? I didn't hear you.
I said, can you touch on last season, last football season, about everything that happened and for me, all that.
Man, last football season was crazy. Never, like no fans. First of all, let's start with
no fans. I was there.
Yeah, I did see that actually. Yeah, you were one of the fans.
Family there. All we had was family there, and whoever came showed up for family. That's what we had. If not, then it was just us on the sideline with our energy. Like it really showed, like how much of our sideline helps us during the game for energy. Like have we had to feed off because we feed off each other, and it showed how much we feed off each other this year.
Yeah,
and for COVID protocols, we was one of the schools, like few schools that got to play all 9 games in the Big Ten.
Okay,
got through a healthy. Thank the Lord of that, and was able to do all that because some schools wasn't able to do all that.
Yeah,
and we were able to play every Saturday and all 9 weeks of it.
Mm-hmm.
So testing every day,
man.
In an isolated bubble from everybody pretty much, and like we really. Our culture is built on sacrifice, like family trust taught. Families forget about me, I love you, love is sacrifice. And we really showed that, how much we sacrificed, because we all sacrificed something whether it was parties, girls, you know, it's college.
Yeah.
Especially when you're a freshman coming in, it showed that the freshmen are like they really matured. I applaud them because I know it could be hard as a freshman coming in. You're free for once in your life, and I applaud them and applaud the rest of my teammates and coaches. Not just the coaches, but the people in the staff too.
Yeah.
Because it took everybody that's in this program that without everybody in this program, we weren't able to play all 9 games this season.
Yeah. Oh, that makes sense. That makes sense. And man, I can, to hear that as your teammate, right? If I was your teammate and a freshman and I heard that coming from you, that would mean a lot to me because you're right. That takes a lot of sacrifice, you know what I mean, to do that stuff and to be away from family, friends, girls, parties.
Oh, yeah. Everything.
Like you said, everything you can do. Like, you know what I mean? You want to do it and you can't. So, man, that's huge. And like I said, that shows the character that your teammates have, you know what I mean? And the people, the people, like you said, that's family for sure, you know? So
we was going strong since June, since we reported back off and on. So mentally, like moving quarantine, outbreaks,
and that's
your family, like it really demonstrates like how much you're strong mentally. Like it takes a lot of mental for like to do that. It's not easy, not for a lot of people, especially for freshmen, like coming in that want to see their family. Yeah. You couldn't really do that because we had to be isolated. And if you want to play this season, we knew what we had to do, the sacrifice, and we all bond in and look what we achieved.
Wow, you said since June, and that was like literally in the midst of the pandemic too. Like
pandemic.
Wow, like
when we didn't know if we was having a season, then we found out we weren't. It was still going on. Then found season. Like we was all traumatized. Like the season was like
I can imagine
canceled, and because we put so much work in, and we was ready, put so much work in, and just to get the season canceled, it was just like it was like damn. Mm-hmm. Then we got the season back up. We was all hyped.
Yeah.
That's an interesting timeline. I'm just like thinking in my head and stuff like that because like when you think about the timeline, like you reported in June, like what you said, like that's still pretty fresh. Like you know, February, March, April, May, June. Like you know, we're like 4 or 5 months into it. A lot of uncertainties. A lot of like we don't know about things. You know, we did see the NBA go through their bubble and stuff like that. You know, and it worked really well and stuff. So I guess you know like. You guys had an opportunity to see kind of how it worked, but man, like arriving like that and you guys are, you know, young men and stuff like that. Like that's not an easy thing to do. You know what I mean? Like to do all those sacrifices and stuff like that. That's crazy. So seriously, hats off to you, you know, to Rutgers football team, you know, to you guys and seriously Rutgers football team. Cause that shows a lot of, you know, who you guys and the character that, you know, that team has. So,
thank you. Yeah. We really think that. So,
You know, so you scored a touchdown this year. Let's talk about that because you know, let's talk more about that because it's not an everyday thing that you see in any level. You know, linemen catching passes for touchdowns. So. Walk us through it, you know, talk us more about it. Like, you know, what was it, you know, talk us about the call and, you know, just talk about it, man. Let's hear it.
All right. So when they told me, I was all excited because I'm like, yo, I got hands like, yo, throw me the ball.
Like, he's been wanting the ball for 3 years.
Yes. Yo, I can catch, like, throw me, like, I can tell the quarterbacks, throw me a bullet. I bet you I catch it. Like, I try to, like, I just like for fun, just like, say I got hands for a line.
Yep. Yeah.
So when they told me to play, it was just like in the meeting room, it was just like all laughing and cheering, like, oh yeah. Mm-hmm. So play, of course it has to be on the goal line. I mean, I got speed, you know, I could juke anybody out there. Maybe they don't talk about all that right now. This is getting talked about the play. So we on the goal line play. So we see a guy in motion, like we knew he was going to man. We sent him in motion. I saw it. And I knew it right then and there. So, you know if you've seen it or not, but I tapped my guard, my bro, Cedrice. I tapped him. I was like, yo, bro, here it is. I was like, you better block for me. I was like, you better block for my ass.
You better block.
So, you know, I had, in order for the play to work, I had to get behind the quarterback.
Yeah.
So I could be eligible, like backwards pass.
Backwards pass. Yeah.
Did that. Yeah. Caught it. Just had a now time to score.
Yeah, the rest was history. I mean, yeah, no. If you guys haven't seen it, go check that out because yeah, that was definitely a play that like I said, you don't see very often.
So. You gotta watch that. You gotta frame that picture too. You gotta frame that. Yeah, you gotta.
Oh yeah, I got to. I'm gonna frame it. I'm gonna frame the Indiana one too.
You did show me that one too. For real, that one was dope too. So so for you, you know, for those that don't know, you, like you said, you study graphic design, you know, at Rutgers University. So how did you first get into graphic design?
I've been drawing my whole life. I drew my whole life. I started with Dragon Ball Z characters, and Dragon Ball Z is one of my favorite animes. And to that, I was watching the NBA, not the NBA, the NCAA tournament.
Okay.
And I seen the court, how they made it 3D and had a video playing. I got interested in that. Uh-huh. And then I got interested in making logos. So that I talked to my guidance counselor throughout high school, just the route I wanted to go is graphic design.
Yeah.
Because it's like, it's my love. Then on the long side of that, I picked up photography on that too. Like fun, just for fun, really. Uh-huh. But since I've been a graphic designer, I've made my own logo, made a flyer, I made a logo for my mom's company.
Okay, awesome.
And I just done stuff on the side for like just for fun purposes. I still learning. And I got a little portfolio. Huh?
You got a little portfolio.
Well, I got a little portfolio. It's on my Instagram page. And I have an internship with Creative Services.
Okay.
Rutgers Athletics. Been at it almost 2 years now, I believe. Mm-hmm. In the summertime, made 2 years. Yeah. And
what do you do in that program?
Oh, with all the athletic department, with design, photography. I'm still learning a lot more under Andrew and Flynn and Matt. I'm learning a lot under them and how to build my network and branding.
Do you plan on continuing graphic design after football?
Yes. Yes, absolutely. My plan is either to come back in athletics when my career is over or freelance. I haven't really decided, but I'm leaning more towards the athletic department because I was like, that's what I know. I know how to most fun in that.
Yeah, being around sports all the time, right? Being around, being around athletics, absolutely. Covering athletics, that makes sense, yeah.
That's good, though. And do you know anything about financial literacy?
Not as much, not you. I see you explain it. I seen on your page explaining a little bit, so.
Yes, sir. So I
should learn more.
Yeah, so my brand basically about Just Cash and it's trying to educate people, basically, mostly the younger generation, like 20s, 18, basically after high school, about financial literacy. And people don't teach you about like credit, stocks, real estate. They don't want to teach you all that in high school, which they should. That would be a great tool for being an adult, especially, and not just wasting their credit. They want everybody to have bad credit, try to like work 9 to 5 every day. We know how to do that. We can make money work for you. And not putting your savings. Actually, I read today that if you put something in your savings, you're losing like 25th of the dollar because of inflation. And everybody wants to be like putting your savings. And yeah, and you only get like 0.001 of your money if you put it in your savings. So basically, you're losing in that.
Yeah.
When you can make your money work for you. Yeah, but you can make the money work for you in other ways. Like, invest, just put cash. In stock, yeah, just cash. Yeah, but yeah, that's mainly my brand is all about. Yes, sir.
Sir. No, you're right though. You can absolutely make your money work. Stock, bonds, you know, all those different things. One of the easiest routes to kind of go through is through your bank. You know, you go to your bank, you know, you tell them that you, if you don't have a credit card or something like that, you can go to your bank, your local bank, talk to them about opening up a credit card. A lot of times they actually have student credit cards that you can actually go into. That's actually one of my first credit cards that actually I had as a student. When I was in college, I started off, went to my local bank basically, and, you know, started talking to them about credit and stuff. And, you know, they recommended a little student credit card, and, you know, and basically it built from there. And now I have, you know, whatever, you know, but yeah, you know, it starts small, but, the little small things, they add up quickly, you know? So, you know, and a lot of times now to kind of do a lot of things, you really have to have outstanding credit, you know what I mean? So yeah. That's one of the other things that you want to make sure you're building is, you know, make sure you're building that credit. And, so yeah, no, you absolutely.
Yeah, I just got my first credit card when I was home on break. So
there it is. See,
got my first credit card.
Don't spend all the money on there, okay? Hey,
huh?
Don't spend all the money on there now. All right,
no,
you're down to like I'll say 30%. You'll be fine. Just make sure you pay it off whatever you have. Don't.
Yeah.
Hey, yes, sir.
That's what they always used to tell me. Yeah, they always just tell me like just like put some gas in or something and then pay that off. You know what I mean? Like you know. Just so you're building it up, you know what I mean? So they see that you're able to pay that off right off the back. But yeah, you don't want to leave a big balance, because then that starts kind of taking some ticks off the credit score, you know what I mean? Because then they start seeing that you have like outstanding balances and stuff like that. So, I want to transition to mental health. So one of the other things that we, you know, that we talk about is mental health. And I like to actually really talk to, you know, the athletes about, you know, what they feel about mental health. So, you know, Raekwon, what does mental health mean to you?
Everything. Like, our minds are the most powerful thing, and we need that. Something not to play with is very serious, especially someone that dealt with concussions. It's very serious. It's a very serious matter. And I've done presentation on concussions, CTE, on how it could affect you. Mm-hmm. And it's like how like the brain like transforms itself. It's like from a normal brain to a CTE. To CTE brain is not something to play about. I feel like that should be like talked more like actually in depth about. It's not talked about enough on how like after NFL guys, not just NFL guys, any athlete that does deal with this, and it's not talked about enough. It's like they're not getting like the help they deserve, the need. And that's very important to me. Like, we should be able to help these guys.
Yeah.
Like, we got all the resources, but we're not putting it to use.
Wow.
Yeah.
No, you make a great case, because honestly, like, when you think about it, seriously, do you guys remember that movie with Will Smith, the one that he did? Right. Oh, yeah. Okay, so before that movie, it wasn't really talked about too often, right? He kind of brought like that movie kind of brought it into light a little bit more, and it kind of like started making some headlines, right? Like people started realizing, oh, like
for real.
I mean, like we always knew that obviously that contact sports did something obviously to people, right? Like from back, you could tell from people like in the 70s that played different people like that, you know, they start seeing it. But honestly, we never really understood what it was until they, you know, we started bringing that to light. But you're right. It still isn't, even to this day. We're in 2021, and we still don't talk enough about it. But now it actually brings a question that just popped into my head right now. Do you think that we don't talk about it enough because football is such a huge sport here in America, and because of that reason, we don't want to like kind of like damage that, you know, we don't want to damage it? Because honestly, when you think about the NFL, right, we think about the shield, right? It's always talk about the shield. Do you hear that, right? They protect their own NFL, right? So do you see that possibly being a reason why they don't talk about it, because they don't want to damage the name of football, maybe?
It could be, but like here's their – I feel like they will debate that they're making safer helmets, which is true. They're making safer helmets. So you can see they put some type of work in for extra, safer helmets.
Yeah.
But as I think is just like – it's a topic that it's a hard topic that no one wants to discuss about. There's a lot of topics that's a hard discussion that no one wants to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, for instance, racism. No one wants to talk about that. It's a hard topic. Everyone wants to avoid it. Oh no, this and that is all right. It's just like a hard topic no one wants to talk about. It's very avoidable, and like this and that. It's just like, it's a lot of this and that, and not just trying to attack the situation straight on. Because I think people just fear like they will start pulling out. I mean, they made rules to make the game safer. Yes, they're making rules to make the game safer, making better helmets. It's just like a topic that no one wants to discuss.
They're trying to protect their players. Especially with the new targeting rule, trying to protect everybody, make sure nobody tackles somebody weird or like puts their head down. Just trying to make the game safer from what it used to be. Even if they say it's soft or anything, they're trying to protect everybody at the end of the day.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's what I think. It's just they put in the work. It's just a hard time to discuss about.
Yeah.
Because there's been lives that's been lost because
absolutely. Yeah. So, I actually just heard, I was watching the I Am Athlete podcast, right? And I think one of them, I can't remember who it was directly. I don't know if it was Chad or Fred or one of them, but they said they were going to donate their brain because they actually were talking about this and stuff. And they said, because they said, to be honest with you, I'm going to donate my brain because, they were like, what else am I going to do with it? Like, what am I going to do with my brain? You know what I mean? So he wanted to donate it and stuff, which I mean, I applaud him because man, you're right. I mean, what else are you gonna do with it? But no, like it gives another reason that we could, dig deeper into what goes on. Mm-hmm. And like you said, because man, the brain is, man, that's a crazy tool. You know what I mean? It's a crazy tool and it's a powerful tool. Like what you said, mm-hmm. It's depending on how you use it. You know what I mean? No, you're right though. So.
Yeah. But staying on mental health, Raekwon, do you think it's important to be mentally prepared before games?
Yeah, you have to be prepared for a game. You have to be in the right mindset to get ready. It's all about your preparation, really. Just make sure you're prepared for the game. And what's like, it's your job. You can't, your brothers to your right or your left is dependent on you to do your job.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not suitable to do your job, you can't be out there on the field.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Is there anything you do like specifically to make sure you're mentally prepared before games?
Meditate. I really meditate and I really focus on meditating the night before the games, pre-game, even during the game.
Okay.
Just to make sure when it starts to go chaos, it goes right back here. And Coach Shiano, he really emphasized meditating too. I remember one game. I think it was a Michigan game. He pulled us to the middle of to the 50-yard line on the sideline, told us all to come here, just told us to just breathe, relax, bring the game. The game started to get out of hand. He just brought us all in and calmed us down. So Coach Yano's a big part of that too. A big help of that too of meditating.
Yeah, that's huge. That's big because a lot of people, like what you said, they just get so fast, right? Like the game can be just so fast for people at times, right? And then you don't understand. You got to be like, yo, like you're good, bro. Just take literally breathe and just breathe. Work through it. You know what I mean? Just like you got it. So like, wow, like, that's good. That's good. First of all, that's a good coach because like he sees the signs, he sees the players, he knows you guys. And he's like, listen, let's go. Come over here. Like, you know what I mean? Like y'all just need to chill. We got this. Like breathe. Let's go. You know what I mean? Regroup. So that's a big one. I like that.
Yeah. My high school coach too, head coach, had the saying in high school, it was like fight up. Forget about it and drive on.
Yeah. I like that.
You can fix it in the film room. Just, right now, we just need to lock in and focus on the next play.
Yeah. That's how it is as a coach too. So different sport, but I coach baseball, like we talked about before. And, it's the same thing kind of with pitching and stuff like that. It's really tough because you don't want to get into your pitcher's heads by telling them too many things, right? Sometimes you just got to let the player play, right? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You can't be breaking down mechanical things, different things like that during the game. You just got to let them play and let them trust what they have been doing, right, throughout their process. So, so even if that means, hey, coming in, reel it in a little bit, take a couple deep breaths, get back to, the motions and stuff that you've been doing that you know. That's all sometimes athletes need to kind of be like, oh, you're right. Because a lot of times they just overthink things in that mind, or, you know, during that time. So,
yes, especially basketball too. Just speaking of other sports, it reminded me that my coach, Coach Moody and Coach Wayne, they always just say settle, settle. Like when the games are going back and forth.
Yeah.
It's like fast paced game. And now we bring it up. All you hear is settle, 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 settle. And you just like tells us to settle down. Let's run a play. Let's run an offense. Let's run a defense.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Jalen, you got anything else?
That's about it.
Awesome. Well, yeah, I'm gonna wrap it up right here, Raekwon. I want to thank you for coming on today and giving us your time. It was awesome, you know, learning more about you and stuff like that, and how the season went. You know, talking about the touchdown. So, and then obviously the big one, mental health, man. I really appreciate, you know, talking about that. So, yep, frame that picture. So, before we leave though, before we leave, I want to make sure get your social media out there so you know everyone can take a look. I know it'll be up there, so you know if you want to give a shout out to your social media real fast.
All right, my Instagram, Twitter at Raekwon O'Neal. My business page on Instagram is Ray O'Neal.
Photo. It'll be somewhere. Somewhere.
Ray is R-A-I, not R-A-Y. R-A-I.
Tell him, Ray.
Yeah, Ray. My first name R-A-I-Q-W-O-N and O'Neal, O-N-E-A-L. I don't know why a lot of people put eyes, but it's an A, not an I.
There it is. Go ahead, Jalen, finish this up.
Oh, yeah, y'all need to follow me at JChapman17, the letter J, Chapman17. And my clothing brand, Just Cash Clothing. Y'all need to go cop something on my website, JustCashClothing.com. Yes, sir. Y'all better. I'm about to drop my Black History Month design. Y'all need to go check it out. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Follow me at CRZola_19. Take a look at www.empoweralfie.org.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for tuning in.
Yes, sir.